Simon & Schuster Audio presents Mystery, A Seduction, A Strategy, A Solution by Jonah Lehrer. Read by Jonathan Davis. O known unknown, from whom my being sips such darling essence. John Keats, Endymion. Art has something to do with an arrest of attention in the midst of distraction. Saul Bellow. The one thing people never forget is the unsolved. Nothing lasts like a mystery. John Fowles, The Enigma. Introduction. The mystery of mystery. The most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. It is the source of all true art and science. He to whom the emotion is a stranger, who can no longer pause to wonder and stand rapt in awe, is as good as dead. His eyes are closed. Albert Einstein. The Case of the Missing Writer. On the night of December 3, 1926, Agatha Christie put her young daughter to bed, grabbed her fur coat and suitcase, and left the house in a gray Morris County. She told the maid she was going out for a drive. The next morning, Agatha's car was found near a chalk pit. It had been driven down a rutted dirt road before careening off the track onto a grassy slope. The lights were left on, the brakes had never been applied. According to the New York Times, the Morris County had been found with its front wheels actually overhanging the edge. The car evidently had run away, and only a thick hedge growth prevented it from plunging into the pit. Agatha was gone. At the time, she was a little-known mystery writer. That spring, she'd published The Murder of Roger Ackroyd, her third novel featuring the detective Hercule Poirot. The book was ingeniously constructed. The narrator turned out to be the killer, but only sold a few thousand copies. Agatha was disappointed, as she needed money to finance her fancy lifestyle. She depended on three household servants. To add insult to economic injury, her husband, Archie Christie, had fallen in love with a younger woman. He kept asking for a divorce. The police initially suspected suicide. Agatha had visited her chemist a few days before. They had a morbid conversation about the best drafts for a painless death. Near her crashed car, the police found an open bottle of poison, lead, and opium. It seemed like a simple tragedy. A spurned wife had taken her own life. But if Agatha had killed herself, where was the body? The police hired divers and drained a nearby pond. They scoured the Surrey Downs with bloodhounds. After the authorities put out a call for volunteers, thousands of amateur detectives showed up to look for the missing woman. But the crowds found nothing, not even footprints. It was as if Agatha had vanished into thin air. The police officer in charge of the investigation, Deputy Chief Constable Kenward, began to suspect that Agatha had been murdered. Kenward was the kind of detective that Agatha Christie liked to invent in her novels. A man of deduction, he'd been awarded the King's Police Medal for closing several difficult murder cases. Kenward had a trim mustache, a bulging belly, and a fondness for fedoras. When it came to Agatha's disappearance, Kenward fixated on the fur coat she'd left behind in the back seat. As Kenward noted, the temperature at midnight was 36 degrees. A damp wind was blowing in from the northeast. Why then hadn't Agatha taken her coat? Even suicidal people want to stay warm. Kenward was also suspicious of the crash. The car had been driven down a hill, but there were no skid marks on the dirt. Why hadn't the driver tried to brake? The canvas roof was still attached, and the paint remained unscratched. It was as if, Kenward thought, Someone had carefully driven the car to the edge of the cliff. And then there was the Archie problem. Kenward knew Archie wanted a divorce. The servant said he'd had a bitter fight with Agatha the day before. When Kenward asked Archie where he'd been the night of her disappearance, he admitted that he was with his mistress at a friend's house. Worst of all, he'd burned the letter Agatha had left for him, telling the police that it was a private matter. Kenward found the husband vague and defensive. Yet Archie had a solid alibi. His friend swore Archie had been with him all evening. The car was in the garage, and he would have heard the dog bark. And even if Archie had snuck out, Kenward couldn't figure out how he'd have returned before morning. It was too long a walk, and there was no sign of a second car. And why would the killer have left the poison behind? Days passed. A reward of £100 was posted, but that only led to errant sightings. Agatha was dressed as a man on a London bus. She was wandering around Battersea. She was on a train to Portsmouth. The more Kenwood learned about the case, the more mysterious it became. Every lead was a dead end. As the press swarmed, Archie panicked. In an interview given to the Daily Mail 6 days after Agatha went missing, he speculated that Agatha had staged her own disappearance. It was a literary exercise, not a crime. Some time ago, she told her sister, "I could disappear if I wished and set about it properly." He remembered. They were discussing what appeared in the papers, I think. That shows that the possibility of engineering a disappearance had been running through her mind, probably for the purpose of her work. The public didn't buy it, but Archie was right. Agatha hadn't been kidnapped or murdered. She had vanished herself. As the biographer Laura Thompson observes, Agatha's disappearance was, in many respects, her finest mystery story. She had turned her own life into an irresistible whodunit, artfully placing clues that captivated the public. It was, the Times declared, one of the most sensational disappearances that ever enlivened the columns of the English newspapers. Before she vanished, the public didn't know who she was. They only cared because she couldn't be found. On December 14th, 11 days after Agatha Christie was first reported missing, a banjo player at the Swan Hydropathic Hotel in Harrogate noticed that a woman on the dance floor closely resembled the missing writer. The musician told the police, who passed on the tip to Archie. When Archie arrived at the Swan, he was told by the police to wait in the lobby. The hotel manager said that Agatha would soon descend for dinner. She'd already made a reservation. After a few minutes, Archie spotted her on the staircase, dressed for another night of dancing in a pink georgette evening dress. Agatha calmly returned his gaze, then took a seat by the fireplace in the lounge. After a few minutes of awkward silence, the couple headed into the hotel restaurant for dinner. Although Archie wished to remain silent, the hordes of reporters demanded answers. Agatha's disappearance remained front-page news. To appease the papers, Archie gave a statement to the Yorkshire Post. "There is no question about her identity. She is my wife. She is suffering from a complete loss of memory and identity. She does not know who she is. She does not know me. I hope that rest and quiet will put her right." Archie assumed his explanation would end the spectacle, that he could soon return to his golf game and mistress. However, as Laura Thompson notes, this only proves that Archie did not have a clue about what he was doing, what he had become mixed up in. Perhaps if he'd read Agatha's fiction, he would have appreciated the appeal of a good detective story. Agatha, of course, knew exactly what she was doing. As a crime writer, Agatha understood the allure of the unknown. The best stories give us tantalizing clues but withhold the answer for as long as possible. The detective story was the story of the chase, Agatha would later declare, not the catch, the chase. And she had just engineered the perfect chase. Although Archie blamed amnesia for her disappearance, Agatha was writing again within days. Before she crashed the car, she'd been struggling to finish her next detective novel. There were days she didn't think she'd ever figure it out. Her mother-in-law told the Daily Mail that Agatha walked around the house muttering, "These rotten plots, oh, these rotten plots." It was so hard making the details line up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.